Very often you must be seeing people with excellent capabilities not able to achieve the desired success. You may also be one of them. Why? It's mainly because they lack motivation. Motivation helps us believe that our goal is achievable. It removes doubts and confusion from our head, provides the energy we need, improves our self-esteem and confidence level, and ultimately pushes us to act upon our ideas, our plans, which we usually keep procrastinating. Motivation pushes us to perform at a different level altogether. Don't you see or hear from others so often, if my English was good, I would have been a manager. If my father supported, I would have had my own business. My manager didn't support, else I would have got a promotion. I didn't have a good team, that's why I couldn't do this project properly. Or simply, if there was no traffic jam, I would have reached for the meeting on time. Instead of blaming, complaining, creeping, why don't we think critically and find an alternate way out? Motivation changes such thought process. You stop blaming others for failures, you stop wasting efforts on things you can't control, rather you start preparing to face the consequences. You ignore things which don't matter. You start focusing on what you believe you can do and control. It's called internal locus of control. It's a psychological trait. When a person takes responsibility of his own life, believes that he can control his own life events and influence the outcomes, rather than blaming others for external forces or everything. A person with external locus of control attributes their success or failure to external factor. No successful leader ever blames external factors or other people, but works on what they can themselves do to deal with unfavorable external circumstances. This is the single largest difference between motivated successful people and demotivated unsuccessful people. The former have strong internal locus of control and later have more external locus of control. Focus should be only on things which matter, which you can control. That's it. Rest, everything is waste of energy and time. Real sustainable motivation comes from within, not outside. Few years back, I heard a real story which got stuck inside me. Whenever things don't go as per my expectation, which never goes by the way, this story pops up in my head and I'm back on track. It's a story of Soichiro Honda, a founder of Honda Motor Company in Japan. You all have seen his Honda cars and bikes all around, didn't you? Thought to share this story with you all and also draw your attention to key differentiator because of which he ultimately succeeded and many others don't. Maybe it will make you assess yourself and motivate you to change a few things if needed. He was born in Japan in November 1906. Mother was a weaver, father was a blacksmith who ran his bicycle repair shop. He used to buy broken bikes for knockdown price and then repair and sell those. Soichiro Honda was studying automobile engineering. As he was from a poor family, he wanted to earn as quickly as possible. He had very little tolerance for formal education and wanted to jump into any opportunity to work on his passion for motors. He used to believe if the theory promoted creativity, then all teachers would have been inventors, though he realized his mistake later. So he dropped out of his college, joined a car repair workshop in Tokyo, where he got to learn about nuances of car making. Now in his free time, he started building a racing car, which gave him an opportunity to explore the inventor inside him. This is the first differentiator. Ordinary people waste their free time here and there in doing unproductive things. He didn't waste his free time at young age, but he spent it to learn and create something he loves. He began racing in Japan circuit, but encountered a near fatal accident on the racetrack, fractured his shoulder, damaged his face. So he was forced by his father and wife to give up racing after this accident. This was his first major setback. Then he invested his life savings from his jobs and raises to start manufacturing and selling piston rings which are used in vehicles. He spent several months to set up the factory and start production. He even pledged his wife's jewelry, literally lived in his factory day and night. This is another differentiator. He took huge financial risk to follow his passion, trusting himself and worked dedicatedly. Most others don't want to take chances or get out of their comfort zone. Anyways, he goes to Toyota's purchase department with 100 piston rings he manufactured and convinced them with the idea of buying from him. As he can supply those rings locally, and at cheaper cost due to lesser logistics. Purchase team asked him to take those rings to quality team, who will need to approve those before they can place order. When the quality team saw those rings, they asked him to throw those away, melt them or make something else or sell at a price or scrap. Those were useless, not the right design, strength or measurement. In another version of the story, though, I read he manufactured 30,000 rings and only 3 pairs of quality, but that's not the point. Imagine the humiliation he would have felt and the mental stress he must be in. He left his college education, then his job, then car racing, blessed wife's jewelry, worked hard to set up the factory and make those rings with expectation of car maker buying it, but that didn't happen. After this dejection, his parents advised him to not disregard the importance of formal studies and asked him to complete his engineering. He realized and admitted his incompetencies. He went back to the university. This is another big differentiator. He wasn't shy to admit his failure and incompetency or to go back to the college for learnings which he left years back. I can guarantee that majority of people don't accept their mistake and feel ashamed to go back to the starting point. There again, he had to face humiliation and was being bullied. All his juniors were his peers. They laughed at him, humiliated him. Nevertheless, he refused to give up. Rather than focusing on his failure, he remained focused to learn and completed his engineering. This is another differentiator. After studies, he borrowed money, built factory again, learning from his mistake earlier. This time he ensured that the piston rings are as per Toyota's specification. Finally, he won a contract from Toyota and he started making some money. But the story doesn't end here. Soon there was an earthquake and his factory building collapsed. As the natural calamities were not covered under insurance policy, he had to bear those costs. You know the act of God clause in our insurance policies? Yeah. He had earned some money by then, so he built it again, this time with earthquake resistant technology, and was ready for production. But then the World War II occurred. He had Toyota's contract in hand, but there was no raw material available because of the war. American planes were dropping bombs. Thousands of people died. America was also dropping large heavyweight steel gasoline cans to kill people so that the geographical elements do not get destroyed. When he heard this on radio, he jumped with joy. His parents thought he's crazy, but he said that US president could be his best friend who is giving him such valuable gifts. He put his life at risk to go to places where such steel cans were dropped, transported those to his factory. This is the raw material he needed to make his piston ring. Since raw material was free, it reduced his cost also, and he could think of making decent money this time after the war stops and Toyota begins manufacturing again. So he waited. This is such a big differentiator, isn't it? In midst of such a terrible crisis of a world war and destruction all around, he could maintain a balanced head, sense of humor, focus on himself, see positive things in this crisis, and apply his critical and creative thinking skills to find a solution for non-availability of raw material he needed. That's all what mattered for him, nothing else. How many of us can maintain focus on just what we need, what we can do, and the positive aspect of the crisis we are in? But he had to pass more tests in life. In one of the bombing, his factory got destroyed again. Again, the insurance didn't cover it, as war incidentals were not covered under the policy. This time he lost his money, his assets, the stocks he manufactured. He was in deep financial trouble now. He became dependent on his father again. Imagine his mental state. Another differentiator. Other people would have given up blaming the earthquake, the bombings, luck, God, which are external factors not in our control. Instead, he kept thinking and planning about the future and what he can do next to come out of the crisis. He noticed that after the war, gas supply was extremely short and people were forced to walk or ride a bicycle. So he decided to manufacture a motorized bicycle, a tiny engine attached to the bicycle. But he had no money and banks did not finance him. So again, his creative and critical thinking ability comes into play as his savior. He approached all the bicycle vendors to raise funds and make each of them a shareholder in the company. See, he went around Japan to meet 2,400 cycle vendors. Of those, 237 vendors agreed to put some money in his business. That's just about 10% of people he met. See his perseverance. He didn't give up even after first 100 vendors didn't agree to put money in his business. Another huge differentiator. We all would have given up after 5 or 10 vendors rejected us, assuming that this idea doesn't work. But he kept going. He kept going around with hope and positivity that the next vendor may not reject his proposal. The total money he received from those 200 odd vendors was also decent enough for him to make about 100 motorized bicycles. He called those Honda Lion, his first ever motorized vehicle. He distributed those to the vendors to sell. Do you know how many of those got sold? Yes. Of those 100, only 2 got sold. That too in 6 months. He was terribly shocked and disappointed. He thought that it's a very useful product which will increase people's efficiency, speed, and make their commute easy. There was nothing like it in those days in Japan. He thought, but couldn't figure out what went wrong. So he went around to take customer feedback and then realized where he went wrong. Usually Japanese were lightweight people, slim, and many short-heighted. His Honda Lion was like a lion. It was difficult for Japanese to ride those heavyweight bikes. So his concept wasn't wrong, but his design was wrong again, just like his first piston ring design. So he went back to his factory and trimmed down the remaining 98 vehicles which didn't sell. He made it smaller to suit Japanese physique. Now do you know what it was called? Take a guess. It was called Honda Cub. Lion's Baby Cub. This 98 bikes got sold immediately on release. This is another differentiator. He always had a flexible mindset and was ready to adjust as needed. He understood his customer's need was different. He also didn't let his 98 unsold bike to go waste and applied his creative thinking and transformed that same into a lighter model. After that, he kept progressing in his business. Many of you today must be driving one of his cars or bikes. Note that he was already 42 by the time he launched his company Honda Motors. So it's never late to begin. Today Honda is one of the leading car and bike makers in the world. Honda succeeded because he had extremely strong internal locus of control. Think of his journey throughout. Dropped out from college, had a near fatal accident, got rejected by Toyota, humiliated and bullied by fellow classmates, earthquake destroyed his building. During World War II, he had no raw material and the bombing destroyed his factory. He was in deep financial trouble, no insurance coverage was available. He became dependent on his father again, struggled to get funding to restart, and then the first bikes didn't sell at all. But he followed his passion. He never gave up on failures, never blamed external factors for his failures. He always focused upon things which he believed he can control and not those which he cannot. He always had his critical and creative thinking skills running and was very flexible to keep making adjustments as needed. Steel gasoline cans dropped by US forces to kill people were used as raw material to make piston ring. Who could think that? He worked on things he would control to influence the outcomes he wanted. The challenges and hard times strengthen you and build your character. In a gym, you can't build muscles by picking up a pencil. You need to pick up heavy weights. Everyone wants to go to heaven, but no one wants to die for it. Problems come your way to test your character's strength, and you can deal with it only through motivation. No one motivated Honda. He was self-motivated, self-driven. Self-motivation is the best form of motivation. No other factor is stronger than this. Stay honest to yourself. Do what you believe in, what you love, what you are absolutely passionate about. Else you will have a burnout and lose the motivation. Any failure cannot stop you to succeed if you focus on improving yourself and things you do rather than blaming others. All the best. And if you like the story, tell it to others as well and motivate them. Cheers.
Thanks for listening to me. Please share this video now with others on your Facebook, WhatsApp, Twitter. To get notified about next videos, please subscribe to our YouTube channel and press the bell icon. We'll meet again. Stay happy.